Chapter 2. The Pure Creation. Goddess Shri said, "The supreme state of Paramātman, realized by the sūris alone, is described as devoid of misery and limitation, its essence being the experience of bliss. One Ātman, soul, controls another, yet another is master over the first, and so forth, until when this chain ends, the final soul is called Paramātman, the end of the way of ways. Ātman is that which the word aham, I, denotes. Ātman, when free from all restriction, is known as Paramātman and embraces all things insentient as well as sentient. The eternal I denotes the being called God, Vāsudeva, the great kṣetrajña. He is also named Viṣṇu, Viśva, Nārāyaṇa and Viśvarūpa. His I-hood, as myself, pervades the whole universe." No material or immaterial object exists that is not infused with this I-hood. I-hood is inherent in whatever is stamped as idam, this or phenomena. Viṣṇu is perfectly tranquil, śanta, without activity, changeless and eternal. He is without end and free from all limitations of time, place, etc. The source of that vibhūti, the wide expansion of divine power, is Brahman, the ultimate location of that power where knowledge is free from reference to any object. Brahman is like a waveless ocean of nectar, with the six divine attributes fully manifested. It is unique in the form of concentrated consciousness, quiescent, and not subject to udaya or asta, expansion or contraction. Since in this state of the pure creation, Brahman is not differentiated from Shakti, it is said to be Advaita, non-dual. Its supreme power, like the rays of the moon, is myself, the goddess, the immortal one, who identifies all states of being with her own self, Brahman's I-hood. Hari, being I, is regarded as the self in all beings. I am the eternal I-hood, egoity, of all living beings. I am considered to be the eternal Vāsudeva state of existence. Brahman embraces both the principle of existence and its state of existence. Hence, Brahman is the Parampadam, the ultimate eternal state. When differentiated, the existing principle is God, Nārāyaṇa, and his state of existence is the supreme Lakṣmī, myself. Therefore, Brahman, the eternal, is called Lakṣmī Nārāyaṇa, because the I-entity is always inherent in I-hood. The I-entity is always recognized as the source of I-hood, for the one cannot exist without the other, and each is invariably linked with the other. Realize that the relationship between me and the Lord is that of identity, because without I-hood, the essential quality of I, the I-entity would be meaningless for want of association. Who am I? Similarly, I-hood without the I-entity would lack meaning for want of a basis. What am I? In this world, all objects of direct or indirect knowledge, viewed collectively or separately, are regarded as the principle of existence and its state of existence. That I-hood, the great goddess, remains unmanifested during the time of Brahman's non-manifestation, and, enfolding the universe within herself, exists in Brahman. The first evidence of Brahman's expansion, like the moon rising out of the ocean, is my own self, Nārāyaṇa's Shakti, characterized by Brahman's will to create. The nimesha, closing of the eyes of Brahman, the Supreme Self, at the time of involution and destruction, is also myself, Nārāyaṇa's Shakti, characterized by the will to sleep. My insuperable and unlimited divine power issues from my potential state, the will of God, Nārāyaṇa, to create. Absolute awareness, pure consciousness, is the essence of Brahman, which is omniscient and untainted. The essence of I-hood is also all-knowing and all-seeing consciousness. The absolute state, in the form of both myself and Brahman, is identical with consciousness. The other attributes of divine power, Aishwarya, Virya, etc., are the ever-present attributes of consciousness, whereas consciousness is reputed to be the primary expression of I. Luminosity and transparency are the features of consciousness, just as they are the characteristics of crystal and the light. Hence it is that consciousness is the manifestation of both myself and Nārāyaṇa. In referring to my primal state of creativity, all scholars in all books of knowledge call my sovereignty Aishwarya, as the Ichcha Shakti, power of will. My aspect as the source of the universe is known as Shakti, power. The effortless ease with which I create is known as Bala. Bala also denotes my capacity to sustain creation. Scholars regard this sustaining aspect of mine as part of my Shakti. Although I am the material cause of the universe, Virya, changelessness, is my permanent attribute. When milk turns into curd, it immediately changes its nature. But although I evolve into worldly phenomena, as milk does into curd, these changes of mine have no permanence. Hence, discerners of truth hold that Virya is immutability. Virya is also said to be valor, which is a component of Aishwarya. My capacity to accomplish all things without aid is called my sixth attribute, Tejas, by the enlightened. Some define Tejas as the power to subjugate, yet other scholars of truth regard this attribute as a component of Aishwarya. These, then, are the five attributes directly flowing out further developments of consciousness. All six of these attributes, jnana, knowledge or consciousness, Aishwarya, Shakti, Bala, Virya, and Tejas together constitute my manifestation of the six attributes. This is how a millionth particle of myself, as the will to create, evolves into creation. This particle embraces both groups of creation, pure and impure. Hear, O King of Gods, I will explain the course of pure creation. That glorious manifestation of the six attributes of the Absolute God assumes four forms in which the six attributes gradually manifest themselves or else remain unmanifested. These four forms of manifestation take place in three extraordinary stages. When the presence of the attributes is assumed, but the divine gunas are not yet discernible. When the attributes are in the course of becoming discernible. And finally, when the divine gunas are fully manifested. Through permutation and combination, the three pairs of the six attributes, jnana, aishwarya, virya, shakti, bala, and tejas, constitute the chaturvyuha, the four manifestations of Viṣṇu. When those three pairs of attributes are simultaneously present, in combination as well as separately, that state of mind, the inert one, is known as my fourfold state. Even without referring to my visible manifestations, by basing their deduction merely on the attributes, philosophers identify my fourfold form with my inert state. Through the combination of the three pairs of attributes, this evolution of my supremely inert state gradually becomes discernible. The first of my manifestations in the fourfold state is undistributed, undefined, enduringly pure existence, lacking the concept of particularization, and is known as transcendental existence and consciousness. That is Vāsudeva, my first manifestation, my first evolution from complete inertia. My second manifestation, Sankarshan, embodying the two attributes jnana and bala, enfolds the entire creation, faintly discernible like dark spots on a human body. In my Sankarshan aspect, the wise discern a combination of jnana and bala. Thereafter, in course of the process of manifestation, I gradually become more active. During that stage, I am called the manifester of all created objects, Pradyumna, in which form I manifest the attributes Aishwarya and Virya. And when, through the impetus gained from activity, Kriya Shakti, I am swayed by the will to act, the learned call me Aniruddha. These consecutive and gradual states of mind are described as Suśupti, Svapna, and Jagrat, deep sleep, dream, and waking, respectively. In the course of manifestation, the three attributes, Vijnana, Aishwarya, and Shakti, known as my innate attributes, are generally referred to as my three differentiations. On the other hand, the other three divine attributes, namely Bala, Virya, and Tejas, are gunas auxiliary to Jnana, Aishwarya, and Shakti, and are defined as the eradication of imperfections such as fatigue and the like. Hence, my states are of two types, the inert and the active. My manifestation in creation is only another facet of my existence, which involves no duality, in the same way as waves surging up in the ocean remain the same water. Generally speaking, the form of my manifestation is determined by the particular pair of attributes required for fulfillment of my function and purpose. Hence, jnana in combination with bala is called sankarshana. Aishwarya with virya constitutes pradyumna. And aniruddha represents shakti in conjunction with tejas. Whereas my initial state, vasudeva, the undifferentiated complex of the six attributes, is identified with the absolute entity, Brahman. Just as the same actor may appear in several roles, displaying differences in dress, plot, etc., revealing various traits of character such as persuasiveness, magnanimity, cruelty, valor, etc., so because of my urge to benefit the worlds and by virtue of the attributes, jnana, knowledge, shakti, power, etc., I assume the forms of the Chaturvyuha, yet retain my single entity. My motive is to aid living beings involved in the cycle of destruction, creation, and maintenance by helping them to become acquainted with, deepen their study of, and harvest the fruits of religious instruction through Sankarshan, Pradyumna, and Aniruddha. My Chaturvyuha states include my four states of existence, Turiya, Suśupti, Svapna, and Jagrat. The Vibhava, divine manifestation of the omniscient God, originating with Padmanabha, has innumerable forms. The various manifestations of Aniruddha are revealed in the Satvata Sanghita. The Archa incarnations, temple deities of those whose minds have been purified by God Himself, are also described there. Through the influence of mantras and their presiding deities related to the performance of nyasa, such images also embody the six divine attributes. They are all included in my four vyuha states, starting with my para state and ending with my archa incarnation, and should be regarded as included in my supreme Turiya state and other subsequent states. The difference between the vyuhas and vibhavas is very slight.